Good afternoon. Quiet in the back. I'd like to call to order the Committee of the Whole meeting for Wednesday, October 23rd, 2019. Since we've got a full house, how's the sound back there today? Good? Excellent. Ask if any of the councillors have a conflict of interest that they would like to declare. No? Right on. Item number two, adoption of the agenda. Would somebody like to move? Moved? Seconded? Seconded? All those in favor? Great. Thank you very much. Moving straight on into our first delegation, we've got Ted Bentley from the Sunshine Coast Pickleball Association. Take it away. Oh, and yeah, joined by Karen Renfrew. Make sure you turn your microphone on, and you've got 10 minutes.
Thank you. I'm a director of the Sunshine Coast Pickleball Association, and I sincerely thank all of you for the opportunity to appear today to present our proposal for a dedicated year-round pickleball facility. And I'm proud to be seated beside Karen Renfrew here. She is also an executive member, but more importantly, she brought pickleball to the coast. And we all thank her for that. Ask her all the tough questions. The t-shirt up there says it all. Those t-shirts are on the back of some of our members at a tournament. Pickleball, passion, gotta play. And originally, I had planned a short video here to capture that passion, but I was informed of the time limit, and I know the time limit, and I will play within it. So it's a crazy name, but it's a great game, and let's get into the proposal. So, see if I can handle technology here. There we go. The ask. We are asking for a lease on district land with terms similar to the Racquet Club and assistance in securing grants. More specifically, we have identified two possible locations. Up in the general area of the arena and the tennis facility. And I would like to just point out that the blue lines are lease lines drawn from the SCRD mapping site, and I thank Ben Curry for pointing me in the direction of the mapping site to draw these lines, and to the best of my ability, they reflect the accurate dimensions of both the tennis facility and the proposed pickleball. So this one is south of the tennis facility. I think it has a lot of advantages, but let's take a look at the second location, which is equally viable in our estimation. It is squeezed in between the two existing facilities, and I guess one of the potential negatives, but not insurmountable, is the lot line between district lots 10 and 9 would have to be modified or eliminated. The advantage, I suppose, of this site is that it leaves most of lot 10 undisturbed for other uses. It utilizes, I think, very efficiently the overall site. It's a little bit more awkward for everybody, but it's doable in my estimation. In terms of the actual facility, now this dome happens to be a newly installed dome at Bear Mountain, but we are proposing, primarily for financial considerations, an air-supported dome versus a permanent steel facility. I should say we're certainly open to the steel facility, and we have an interesting opportunity right now if we're prepared to act before the end of this month. So I don't want to put any pressure on, but there was a facility that was earmarked for a maritime application that was wiped out by Hurricane Dorian. And the company that manufactured this has contacted us, or we contacted them first, but they said, we'll give it to you at half price. So we have a similar size facility at half price if we can sign on the dotted line at the end of the month. But you know, realistically, probably not going to happen. I think the air-supported dome is a good way to go. It's tried and true in the tennis world, and we would certainly be happy with that facility. And I should say, when we look at the next slide, that the little building outside the main one is the entrance and washroom building. We're obligated by bylaw to have a separate building because we can't put in a dome washrooms, apparently. So that's why that building is there. And there'd be a concourse probably with fencing leading into the dome. So you see the nine courts there, similar configuration to what we play in when we have the arena. And that long rectangle at the top is intended to use a schematic for the viewing area. I should stress that the netting that we would be using for the pickleball is removable. So this would render the main dome facility usable for other activities, and we can talk about some ideas at the end if we have time. In terms of capital cost, we have a firm quote here from a Canadian manufacturer, Farley, which is based just outside of Guelph, Ontario. They've been in the business since 1999 and have sold 800 domes worldwide. Locally, they've supplied tennis domes to Jericho, Arbutus, Vancouver Club, Richmond. They have a very good reputation, and that's a firm quote, including all of the necessary equipment to operate the dome. In addition to that, there are a couple of other big ticket items. The grade beam is the anchor for the dome, and that's a perimeter of concrete, about 6 feet deep. And the floor, of course, is a big ticket item as well. Now, we have costed these out, and I think these are reasonable estimates, but they're not as firm as the dome itself. And I guess, given the talent and the community-minded spirit of our membership, and more generally that on the coast, I think maybe we could get some in-kind service and material donation to trim those costs. And of course, I'd love to see a bigger contingency there, but I think the $890,000 is a realistic bottom line. Annual revenue, we again have experimented with different membership dues models, and the $85,000 is very realistic, given that we've got over 200 current members. It's premature at this point to actually talk specifics about our dues model, but we've got a number of ideas here, and again, it's a realistic estimate. Drop-in fees, again, I think maybe we're a bit conservative, but $10,000 is reasonable. Tournaments, now that's an interesting one, because with a quality facility, we can run tournaments and they are a good revenue generator. More importantly, tournaments and skill development are a good way to attract people to the coast. Around the continent, there are more and more skills workshops being offered for pickleball, 5-day type workshops, where people come in, spend the time, do the workshop, and we all benefit. Pickleball benefits, the community benefits. Other possible sources of revenue include sponsorships and grants, but I haven't put them up there because totally unknown at this point. Annual operating expenses. Now, I had to put this slide up because this was a poster in your entranceway and people were encouraged to put, "Why do I love Seashelt?" And front and center there is, that's where I discovered pickleball, and I swear, I didn't put that up there. I have rumor that Mayor Seegers put that up there. Anyway, on to the expenses, utilities. I asked the dome supplier for detailed consumption estimates, and they provided them. I got a spreadsheet of those. I converted to BC Hydro and Fortis Gas, and they come in just under $45,000 a year. To keep the dome up, to keep it heated, that's 8 to 10 operations, 7 days a week. Those are firm. Debt servicing is the scary one. I've allowed $60,000 there. I would love to drive that down. And we would be working hard to drive that down. It does service $800,000 at 4% over 20 years. So it's doable. And then the other costs are as they appear there. Again, love to increase that contingency, but there's our operating. To move into summary, it's the fastest growing sport in North America. That sounds awfully Trumpian in its declaration, but it's been quoted many times, and it is. Many communities across BC are adding pickleball courts, and I've got to bring this one to your attention. In Vernon, the regional district of North Okanagan, City of Vernon and the District of Coldstream provided the 15-year land lease and a $300,000 grant in funding towards the court construction. The Vernon Pickleball Association provided the balance of funds along with countless hours of volunteer labor to complete the project. Regional District North Okanagan estimated it would cost the public $1.4 million to construct the facility. This just came out in the Pickleball Canada newsletter a week ago. So there's the challenge, Seashell and SCRD. You're not going to let Okanagan scoop us, I'm sure. The sport obviously is attractive to seniors. It didn't begin that way. It began as a kids' game, and seniors grabbed it. Exercise, we all know, is vital, not just to seniors, but to all, and obviously it's an important component for seniors. Community benefit, okay. We are a growing demographic on the coast. We know that. The Vital Signs 2019 showed 49% of the coast 55 or older. First and foremost, community benefit, I'll be up front, it meets our needs. It meets the needs of the 300 plus pickleball players on the coast. It gives expanded opportunity for families and youth. We would welcome the opportunity to provide programs for a younger group of people. It is a flexible space for special events and compatible sports. And I want to be up front here. First and foremost is the pickleball usage. Critically important to us is that there would be no damage from any other activity to the floor. It's a big ticket item. It's our most valuable asset. Having said that, there are other compatible sports like badminton. Special events could go in there as long as the floor wasn't at risk. It's open space. It's desirable space. Increased opportunity for seashell tourism and retirement. You might think that's a stretch, but it's not. Around the continent, there are resort communities going in. They offer pickleball. Predator Ridge is a good example, offering pickleball. More generally, you will see casinos, cruise ships. Pickleball is on exponential growth. And Larry Ellison in Indian Wells has introduced pickleball. The Nationals are there. And Larry is no dummy. So he's got the second biggest tennis garden in the world. Having pickleball next month, the Nationals are there. So it's growth. So the location too, from a planning perspective, it expands and concentrates seashell recreation. I think that's a desirable attribute to have all these activities up located in the same area. I will almost conclude here with a couple of statements from the executive summary of the SCRD, Parks and Rec Master Plan. Monitor the needs of the population over 55 years of age, including those over 70. Thank God I'm included. To determine where there is a lack of activities and opportunities for this age group and provide age-specific opportunities. Plan and promote programs for older adults, 55 to 70, based on different levels of ability and avoid marketing this group as seniors. Curious. Establish a grant allocation policy, a set of criteria, an application process, and a budget to provide seed money to support groups and organizations who support the achievement of the master plan's goals and service level requirements. I think there is a terrific alignment here between those goals and our sport. I end with a thank you. See you on the courts. Is it an easy task at hand? No. Is it doable? Yeah. It's doable because of that exponential growth of the sport and because of the enthusiasm and general spirit of this community, and in particular, the pickleball group behind me. So again, thank you, and questions, Karen welcomes.
Thank you very much for your presentation. It's clear by the attendance here tonight that you're very dedicated. And thank you so much for doing all this legwork on this facility potential. I have one question on my notes before I turn it over. We've met previously, early discussions. There was some discussion at one point about reusing waste heat from the arena's ice plant. Mm-hmm. Have you looked any further into that or given that any further consideration?
It's a terrific idea, and if, in fact, we had a location between the two existing facilities, I think that would be quite possible. It might be possible with the other location. I love the idea, but short answer to the question, we have not pursued that. In my mind, first comes land, then comes grants and details, but that would be certainly something we would investigate.
Could be a way to help drive your operational costs down.
Absolutely.
Well. Questions? Councillor Rowe?
Well done, first off. Love the looks and the idea. And I totally agree that somewhere that you could have a tournament would be a great, great thing for you guys to generate some revenue to help offset some of those costs. Can you just tell me a bit about the floor that you put in? What is it for pickleball?
We would put in, again, this is a detail that we will have to investigate more carefully, either asphalt or concrete as a base. I know the Rackets Club, the tennis club, has a concrete base, and that would be preferred if cost permits. I think that's the way we would go. Then on top of that, you have multi-layers of special paint that provide a little bit of cushioning and a little bit of traction on the surface, and then on top of that, the pickleball lines.
And that's in particular what you need to protect?
That's what we need to protect, yes.
And just one other question, when you speak to assistance with grants, drill that down a little bit. Does that mean we would like the District of Seashell to grant us some money or some help writing grants, or just clarify that a bit if you would?
For sure, help writing grants or at least giving us backup to our grant application. That yes, indeed, this makes sense. Of course, we'd love to see some dollars from Seashelt and SCRD. The Vernon Challenge is there. But at this point, and we have a team behind me that will be writing grant applications, but first we need the land. We can't go forward uness we have land, and then we'll be writing grants and try to drive that capital cost down, because it's critically important in my mind and our minds that membership be affordable. Mm-hmm. Also drop-in fees, the public access be affordable. And one thing we've had in mind from day one is that we are going to make this no more expensive than the tennis membership. It'll be cheaper than golf. It should be one of the more desirable, more accessible activities for Sunshine Coast residents.
Thank you.
Councillor McLean.
Yeah, thank you. I think this facility presents a tremendous opportunity for the community, so thank you for moving it forward. I just want to be crystal clear on what we're doing here. Mm-hmm. Your primary ask today is for a lease, is that correct?
Correct.
Okay. So we can keep that in mind. Hopefully we can move towards a decision. And I'll just tag a second question onto that. How long do you expect the building to last? Are these things 50-year buildings or...?
The steel building's 50 years.
Yeah.
The air-supported structure is a 20-year lifetime. Now, that's what Farley... It's a decreasing guarantee or warranty on the building for 20 years. Now, That doesn't mean the full cost of $435,000 would be payable at the end of that period, because you've got the lights and some of the other services that could possibly be used again. But it is a 20-year, and that's partly why I used a 20-year amortization on the debt servicing.
Councilor McLean, follow up?
Yeah, I'll follow that up. So I recognize that pickleball is taking off exponentially. My concern is that could it drop off just as quickly as well? I want to make sure that when we're supporting something, that it can last, I guess, in this time is the 20-year time frame. So that's probably my primary concern with this. And if that does happen, could you speak a little more to the alternate uses that we could have for this building? So I think you said badminton. Are there any other sports that it could be used if pickleball really started to drop off? I don't think it will, but I want to make sure that we have our bases covered.
Fair enough. Well, tennis comes to mind. You know, I guess pickleball began in 1965, and it's taken off really in the last dozen years. I'll put my money down, and I will put my money down, that 20 years from now it's going to be around. Having said that, the one advantage of an air-inflated structure is you can take a pin. It's a little bit of an exaggeration, but the air-inflated structure could be removed. I hate to talk like this, because I don't think it will be, but it could be removed. What have you got? You've got outdoor courts left for the facility. But, you know, it's not going to happen. Other activities, you know, there is the potential for a Christmas craft fair. You could have... besides badminton, I suppose specialized activities, maybe a yoga retreat. I've heard other slightly far out there suggestions, like people wanting to fly their drones. That one scares me a bit, because I want to protect the floor, but I also want to protect the vinyl. So, you know, we would be receptive to these other uses. Again, I stress, second to the primary application, and we have such a strong membership that we're going to be utilizing that facility a lot of the time. And you saw in our five-year plan, we're expecting 20% growth in pickleball membership, and that's our organization. Beyond that, there are lots of players on the coast. In Pender Harbor, there's a group that plays in the high school there. Some of them are members, but not all. Now, I suspect some of them would definitely come down to this, but, you know, play will likely continue elsewhere as well.
Thank you.
And it can always be part of the lease, too. If this starts to go downhill for whatever reason, that they would be responsible for, you know, asset disposal, so to speak, so that the municipality doesn't end up stuck with it. Mayor Seegers?
Thank you. Thank you for the presentation. And one of the meetings that we had, you talked about numbers in Ottawa. Do you care to indicate what those are comparatively? Because it was, I think
it's
was
in
it you?
The actual proposal. Yeah. I tend to research more BC.
Okay.
In Ottawa, in 2011, so I'm just reading here, yeah. Pickleball in Ottawa barely existed. Today, there are 100 courts throughout the city. The pickleball onslaught has Ottawa Pickleball Association rethinking how to manage play. So founded in 2014, Ottawa Pickleball Association has grown to 425 members. By comparison, SCPA, with a population base of 2% of Ottawa, has 230.
Right.
But, you know, a better comparison is Coquitlam, Burnaby, Vancouver, and then... I hate to bring up Vernon again, but I will.
Okay. I noticed in your presentation you talked about an automated door entry.
Yes.
So there wouldn't, at this point, you're not anticipating staff.
Staff would be desirable, but I don't think we can afford it. And, you know, with current technologies, I've researched that a little bit, there's some really interesting opportunities available where you can not only provide door entry, but you can monitor the activity, who's going in. The monthly cost of that service is very reasonable, maybe $60 a month, depending on the level of service that you subscribe to. So that seems very appealing to me, to be able to provide entry, maybe hold your cell phone up, you go in, as well as track who's using it when.
Right. Okay, so the ask, you say, is a lease, so it's the land. I think another conversation that would come out of that would be the land clearing and potential servicing. So I know that one of the conversations we've had is around the trees that are on there, and we've had conversations with the preliminary conversation with the community forest around logging and then using that to help do some of the servicing on the lot. So I think all of this would need to be referred to staff to do a little bit more work around that, be able to come back to us with some more financial numbers and you know, how we'd move forward. Thank you for doing this. I know you had a huge group with you last year at the regional district when we were looking at dry floor use, and I'm glad you took this and ran with it and are bringing this forward.
Thank you.
I did have one question for this side of the table, actually. Looking at your site locations, you've got either between the arena and the tennis club, or you've got south of the tennis club. And I'm wondering if we have a preference when we kick this off to staff to look at. I'm particular to keeping it between the tennis club and the arena because it does keep the majority of the site still available for future use. There may be easier ability to tie into the arena's heating system, et cetera. I was just wondering if anybody else had any opinion on that.
I'd prefer as well between, if possible. And I have had preliminary conversations with the regional district around the, and they're open to having conversations around the heat use.
There is another advantage, and that is when I look at the bylaws, there is a provision for sharing parking requirements. If you have like activities and the peak periods are not in sync. So I think we all would like to preserve as much of the land as possible that is outside of a parking use. And this opportunity to share the parking is attractive to us, and I think it would be greater if we had the facility between the two rather than south.
Councillor Scott?
Oh, I agree. In between is perfect. Just one question. You had mentioned that you had a solid structure facility that was available.
Yeah.
What's the cost of that?
The cost of that was at half price, $350,000. Now that comes in kit form. So we would have to call on the folks behind me to erect the structure.
Right. And is that the same size structure that you
it, it, it's actually 100 feet by 200 feet, so it's 8 feet longer, but and it's the same height. It would be a very attractive option, and I'm quite serious that they are holding that open. I've communicated with them saying, look, our timelines I don't think we're going to mesh with yours. It's currently built. They've sweetened the pot by saying we'll paint it to any of the colors you want. So we can put the seashell logo, either the new one or the quadrant, whichever one you want. We'll put it on the side. So, you know, I would love to pursue it. But, you know, my communication with them so far is saying, you know, our timelines, unless we can hold it a little longer, just really hard to accomplish.
Thank you.
That did include shipping.
What kind of time frame did they give you?
Pardon me?
What kind of time frame did they give you?
The end of the month.
unless they don't find somebody else to buy.
That's correct. That's correct. You know, in seriousness, if we could proceed with something that looked promising, but our big challenge would be coming up with the dollars for a down payment. I believe, include shipping. So, but it does come in kit form, and we would talk to our architect, who is one of our best pickleball players, and to see just what sorts of costs to light it, to insulate it, to heat it, and so on? Because that would be my concern right now. It's fundamentally like the existing tennis club in structure, but there are additional costs. It'd be cheaper for the foundation, I'm right. sure. The grade beam, because you don't have to go down and anchor the building. So that would be cheaper. The floor would be the same. But it is a very attractive option at this point. And if we're not successful here, we would not dismiss that in the future, because this one just happened to fall in our lap now, but maybe another hurricane will come along.
Okay. A deposit could hold it, Ted.
Yeah, deposit could hold it.
Anybody else?
You got Eric.
Oh, Councillor Scott.
So when you talked about in your presentation about the debt servicing of it, so I'm guessing that would be the association that would go to the bank and apply for some financing towards this?
In my opinion, it would be a combination of commercial servicing as well as private servicing.
Because I would sit there and, if I was the bank, the solid structure would be the one that I would definitely support.
Absolutely.
I wouldn't support an inflatable structure. So, it still may be on the table.
Thank you for that. Councillor Kooster?
I just wanted to say I agree with putting between the arena and the tennis courts. It makes sense. And I want to thank you for your presentation. I think it's a great idea. Any way we can support health and activity in our community for all ages is amazing. And I hope we can try to move something forward here for you guys. It's a great opportunity even to get the schools involved and younger kids, getting them interested in it. I think it's a great idea. So thank you.
Thank you.
Councillor McLean.
Yeah, I support in between the buildings. I don't know if it's possible, but I'd love to work out something with the tennis facility to share parking. So the simplest version I see is kind of switch the dome and the parking around. So at least this facility's parking is beside the tennis and you two can share. But of course, we have a signed lease with them, so that may be difficult.
I located the parking where I had it in the schematic there, partly because I saw something in our earlier meeting that showed parking generally designated in that area when other activities were being considered for that district lot. So that's why I put it there. But, obviously, if there is some advantage to putting it on the upper portion, by all means.
It's true. It would be easier to share it with an additional facility in the south end of the property in the future. Sounds like we've got some consensus here to... would somebody like to move a recommendation to refer this to staff to look at terms of a lease, including costs and possible moving of lot lines to accommodate between the existing buildings? Councillor Rowe?
I think we should also include the logistics and cost for land clearing and what we could use that for to contribute to servicing.
Okay. Councillor Rowe, does that still...
Yes, and my other comment is, does staff have any input in relation to Plan A or Plan B? I'd like that information to come back as well. So okay. Do you need us to put something together better than that, Joanne? You got it?
Okay. Somebody like to second that? Second it? Any further discussion? All those in favor? Great. Thank you very much for coming.
Thank you.
Thank you, everybody, for coming. We'll give you guys a couple minutes to clear out if you wish. You're welcome to stay. if you guys in the back would like to continue your conversations outside. You guys can leave the chairs. We'll get them after the meeting. All right. Moving on to business. Item 5.1, Planning and Development Procedure Amendment Bylaw, number 566-1, 2019. First, a motion to receive the report. Moved, seconded, all those in favor? All right, I'll turn it over to you, Mr. Allen.
Thank you. This report introduces a few amendments to bylaw number 566. This procedure bylaw was adopted approximately a year ago, a little less than a year ago. And there have been some areas where we have identified room for improvement. It is a good bylaw. It does establish some clear expectations for procedure, but we have identified a few. And the primary topic areas would be there are a few typos, some irregularities and so forth that can be changed, which do require official bylaw amendments. So now is a good time to do so. Expanding the scope of what we consider to be minor development permits. Minor development permits can be issued and authorized by staff. Major permits come to council, and we feel we can refine the scope of what is minor in one particular case. Landscaping security deposits, as well as the bylaw amendment procedure respecting how the sequence of readings, bringing first reading in a little earlier on in the process and what that means respecting additional readings and public hearings. So I'll go through each of these briefly to set the table. Within the staff report, what we have is a copy of the proposed areas of the bylaw with the proposed changes shown in track changes. Should they receive support, we'll consolidate those track changes into a bylaw amendment placed on the future council agenda for readings. So the purpose of today is an introduction, consideration, and questions, of course, should you have any. So I didn't do a slide for the typos. I think that some of them are on one of the schedules, the wrong type of permit is listed. In some cases, acronyms are introduced later than when they're actually used. Just some small cleanup on consistency. Respecting development permits, we think that riparian development permits should be considered minor. In many cases, there might be multiple development permits. Let's say it's a commercial building and there's a creek and there are form and character development permit areas. The form and character component would potentially remain major, but we think that creek setbacks should be considered minor. There's prescripted science respecting riparian areas regulation, identified who is a qualified environmental professional. They have a checklist. The outcomes are setbacks of 10, 15, 30 meters in some cases with what are known as measures, which are our conditions. And then there is some oversight and approval process from the province. A qualified environmental professional would register their report with the province. The province may say, yes, this meets our science criteria, or no, it does not, and further refinements are made. But ultimately, it's based on a professional reliance model, which is standard throughout our development approvals process. That said, there are certain criteria one must achieve to be considered a qualified environmental professional by the province. So nonetheless, they conduct a review, they fill out a checklist, the results are what they are. We think that the process could be expedited and simplified so that upon receipt of that and confirmation that the report meets provincial mandated science or the riparian area regulation, we could then prepare a development permit for issuance. So that's one major topic area. The other one is the landscaping security deposit. We encounter this from time to time. And the amount of security at present is 110%, and it's It's been recommended by staff to consider increasing that to 125%. That allows a buffer and contingency and certain things for either works not done or works that weren't done accordingly. We're dealing with this on some sites, multifamily sites at present, and we feel that there should be a little bit more of a buffer for some of these areas. And then this will allow the Director of Planning and Development to hold more of the security to ensure that landscaping does in fact take, and that if it's sometimes not planted at the right time of year, can lead to failures and so forth. So our park staff and our planning staff do work hard to ensure best chance of success, and we do work with applicants, but we feel that there's improvements that can be made in this regard. And fundamentally what drove this was the zoning and OCP amendment process. As it stands now, we do a fair amount of work, in some cases several months of work, including referrals, before council and public really has a chance to see a bylaw. So what we think is there's always some work that must be done between planning staff and the applicants to ensure proposals are up to a suitable quality. But what we think is that we do some of that work, agree upon what we can move forward with, what our comfort zone is for recommending support. There will be occasions when it comes forward and we don't recommend support, but generally speaking, what we do is provide the parameters of conditional approval. And so what first reading is by no means an approval. First reading recognizes that council has turned its mind to and is willing to consider an amendment to one of our bylaws. And the process is structured by guidance and regulation within the Local Government Act, but it's a little bit more, or it's a little bit ambiguous because it determines a public hearing should be after first reading and prior to third reading, but it doesn't specifically say what to do and when second reading falls into the picture. But in consultation with leading local government lawyers in the province, it's been clarified that, as it has noted, first reading essentially is introduction of the bylaw, after which referrals take place. And second reading is reconsideration. Sometimes there are no changes. Other time there are changes driven to the bylaw based on comments from statutory referrals, Ministry of Transportation, SCRD, if there's water supply, other referrals, community partners, be it Seashelt Nation, be it community associations, neighbors, etc., might provide feedback that neither planning staff, council, nor the applicant had initially considered. And so allowing first reading and introduction followed by referral brings an opportunity for both council and external agencies to have an earlier input into the project. And so we find that this then, what we have now is second and third reading are essentially one and the same under our present process. So this adds value and definition to each of the reading stages. And so typically at second reading is when public hearing would be scheduled. At that point, we've agreed we have the information that we feel we need to be comfortable with to go forward. At a public hearing, we need to make sure that information's on the table. People are generally comfortable with it. And so moving ahead slide here, I got ahead of myself, and so refinements. And then third reading would be then post-public hearing. Third reading is a consideration. We've heard all of the referral agencies. We've heard from the public at the public hearing. Now, if a bylaw receives third reading, essentially what third reading is a commitment to adopt, and in many cases there'd be conditions, could be housing agreement, could be a phasing agreement, could be any number of items, confirmation, but everything has to be on the table prior to public hearing. And then should third reading be accomplished, as I say, it's a condition for approval. Once conditions are achieved, it's then brought back for fourth reading. And fourth reading essentially is just adoption if we're convinced that all conditions have been met. So as I say now, we take quite a bit of time to get the first reading, and then from first reading it's a race to public hearing, and it compresses a little bit of the second and third reading. And so we think bringing first reading in and staging it out properly will provide a clear transparent process that we can align our expectations, council's expectations for review, community engagement, and so forth. And that is essentially a summary of the proposed changes to bylaw 566 for bylaw amendment 566-1. And happy to take any questions on this topic if you like.
Thank you very much. I know I had made a couple of notes, and I'm actually discovered I'm working off the draft agenda, so my notes are null and void. And they have been addressed in the final agenda, so thank you very much. I'm just going to go straight to questions if anybody's got them. Councillor McLean?
Yeah, so I'll start on the landscaping deposit. If I understand this right, the landscaping deposit is in the amount required to do all the landscaping. Does that also include labor?
We would seek a...
It may well do. We would seek a quote for landscaping requirements and what is needed, because we would want labor to be included in the event that we have to then draw upon that money to either hire somebody or have our staff do it.
So that leads me to my next question. Have we run into a case where we have had to step in when a developer does not landscape, and do we know if this 110% is sufficient, or is it... Yeah.
In my brief experience here to date, we are approaching one.
Okay.
We've been dealing with both the present residents, the Strata Corporation, as well as the original developers, and feeling like it's time to move forward, and we've made a decision internally that we need to do this and draw from the money that's been set aside. Mm-hmm.
But it's not a common occurrence. So it may come up, but it doesn't come up regularly that we have to step in and do the work.
Just wanted to point out that part of this is to increase that from 110 to 125%. So I heard you mention 110. I just wanted to clarify that.
Yep.
Mayor Seegers.
Thank you. So somebody puts in landscaping. I think we hold on to the landscape bond or part of the landscape bond. Is there some of that goes back partway through? Hard landscaping gets done. We can refund that amount. But things for trees, amount we keep for trees and vegetation, typically, is it a year, 2 years that we hang on to that? What is the holdback?
Yeah, a holdback would be based upon measures of success. Yes, hardscaping, we know it's done, it's going to work, but it's seasonal performance of whichever is planted. I'll admit I don't know specifically the one versus two, but the intent is to hold that back to ensure that it does work. Yes, thank you.
I had a question about the riparian setbacks. So our development permit areas indicate riparian setbacks. So what you're saying is if they were in conformity with that and there wouldn't be any variances requested, then it could be a minor DP. And if it was something where it was a variance, then it would necessarily still have to come back to council. Is that correct?
Yes, absolutely. That's correct. If it was a variance, that would be through a development variance permit, which is always through council. In some cases, variance can be considered by board of variance. I won't dive into those details just yet, but staff do not contain the authority to change setbacks and zoning bylaws. To draw upon an example, a riparian area assessment area is 30 meters. And let's say the zoning bylaw setback is 15 meters. They do an assessment and the qualified environmental professional confirms, yes, 15 meters is suitable, then it's very minor, it's great. Or if they say 10 meters, we would say your building setback is still 15, but there might be some opportunity for landscaping within. That said, if they come back and say, no, this is a salmon spawning creek, you're on the south side, there's shading requirements, 30 meters is required, then that overrules the zoning bylaw, in which case we would be issuing building permits based on a 30-meter setback. That doesn't happen all that often, but I certainly have seen that. It's possible.
Follow-up. So are you saying that anytime somebody's doing any kind of building around the riparian area, that has to be referred to the province as well? Or is that only... referred here or reviewed here?
there's a reporting system. The qualified environmental professional has a professional code. They have access to an online document management system. They upload their report. The province screens it. So it's not a formal referral like from here, like a bylaw referral, but the province has some staff members who will screen or let's say audit reports.
Thank you for that. Anybody else? Mayor Seegers, again.
Thank you. I like the change moving from, you know, having the public hearing between first and second readings. I've always felt that when the application comes to council, it's actually the first time the community has seen it as well. And so we do know that some referral agencies prefer to have the endorsement of council before they actually do any, you know, definitive work on it for us. But then if it comes to council, first time the community has seen it, we don't actually have an opportunity to incorporate any community feedback into the plan before it goes to public hearing. And then because of the legislation, after public hearing, we can't entertain any kind of changes. So it kind of hamstrings us, I think, with regards to applications. I like the idea that we'd have first reading, get referrals out, get the community to see it, bring that feedback in, incorporate what makes sense to incorporate into, and then go second reading, public hearing. So thank you for the change.
Councillor McLean.
Yeah, I just want to echo the mayor's statement in that I think this change to the zoning process is going to be good for the community and for developers. I'm hoping that it will reduce the need to go back to first reading after making amendments at the public hearing and redoing public hearings several times for the same property. And for the community, it gives them a little extra time to see that, to sit on it, and provide that feedback in a way that we can actually receive it instead of where it happens now. It's kind of like, do we send this back and add a couple months to the development, or do we listen to the community? That's not a decision we should have to make. We should just listen to the community and get that feedback early enough that we can make the change in a logical fashion. So I'm very happy to see this change.
Are you happy enough to move recommendation 2?
Yeah, I am.
Recommendation 2, that Planning and Development Procedures Bylaw number 566-1, 2019, be forwarded to Council for first, second, and third reading. Seconded. Any other discussion? All those in favor? Great. Thank you very much. All right, and Councillor Lamb is taking his leave of us right now. So, moving on to item 5.2, Community Amenity and Affordable Housing Policy 3.5.8. We have a report here from the Director of Planning and Development again. First, motion to receive the report. Moved. Seconded. All those in favor? Thank you. Back to you.
Yes, thank you. I think we have another presentation coming, correct? Okay. Excellent. Thank you. So when I arrived here and I noted that this was high on the agenda, high on the work plan as something to do, and happy to share with you our proposal. So this is the Community Amenity Policy introduction of the new one. So we're calling this one Policy 3.5.8. Now, if adopted, would replace existing policy 3.5.6, which was adopted in 2007. So we do have a policy respecting community amenity and affordable housing, but it's a little bit difficult to use, to implement, and it also references an official community plan that was repealed in 2011. And so Director Douglas and I have been looking at this as he's been preparing the two statutory reserve bylaws, and we've been kind of scratching our head wondering how this works, noting that that bylaw or OCP that's referred to is no longer in force, and saying, hey, this is a timely project. So as the bylaws are meant to provide structure for how to receive and spend the money, and the policy provides some implementable ideas on how to and when to ask for the money. Should it be money in lieu of? Sometimes amenities are units, public art, etc. So I stress that it's not specifically about the money, but what it does is provide more clarity on when cash in lieu of amenities is provided. I once again jumped ahead of myself in my excitement and note that recently you've seen these two bylaws. One has readings and one is pending. But the idea here is statutory bylaws so we can clarify where the money is and how to use it in the future. So strategic plan, section 4.3 speaks to updating the density bonusing policy and amenity contribution policy to better define and incentivize community livability and sustainability. That's the driving goal behind this. Also within the official community plan contains policies respecting the contribution of amenities and affordable housing. So this is the OCP, of course, been in place since 2011, contains a number of policies respecting both these as well as density bonusing. So it is something that we wish to consider, but to provide more specifics, and that's the goal here, provide some more specifics so we can have some clarity in our early discussions with applicants. And based on industry standard and research and so forth, best practices that this applies to rezoning and OCP amendment applications. And we have built-in exemptions. Sometimes the development is the amenity, whether it's a purpose-built affordable housing complex. I often refer to PODs, the Pender Ocean Discovery System proposal in Irving's Landing at Pender Harbor, right? Those types of things can be considered the amenity. So whether if it's a registered nonprofit society for the purpose of affordable housing, for example, would be exempt from this. As well as any outstanding bylaw amendment that already has third reading, as in post-public hearing. If we have any on file where it's too late now because we'd be introducing new information or new requirements, would not apply. But it would apply to applications at or near first reading, as well as future applications, if it is approved. So the policy structure provides for on-site contribution of affordable housing and amenities or cash in lieu. So it doesn't include statutory park dedication. It doesn't include if a commercial complex is putting in green space and public space for the betterment of their residents and occupants. It also provides guidance when amenities or payments will be transferred. It's not always reasonable in some cases, in larger cases, to expect the transfer of amenity payments all at once, pre-construction. Sometimes on smaller projects, it is. One example would be a subdivision on Bly Road. It's at third reading, and there is a requirement there for, it's an 8-lot subdivision, close to $102,000 for affordable housing. So it's an example of one that's already in place, council resolution to support it. But it wasn't born out of a specific policy, but it would be payable upon completion of the rezoning application. And as we move forward towards the end of this, I'll provide a few more examples for some clear understanding. Just catching up here. And so respecting housing, we identify different types of housing, or in some cases, lots for housing at subdivision stage, be it low density, medium density, or higher density. So single family, townhouse, row house, through to apartment buildings, and identify and note a 2% annual increase. So we built in tables so that over the course of 5 years, it's more loosely based on cost of living increase, et cetera. As well as a 10% premium for OCP amendments if one comes in with an application and it deviates from the intent of the official community plan, we propose a premium for that. Noted, there's a 15% reduction also suggested within this. This comes out of policies in the official community plan and strategic plan about downtown first, promoting downtown development. If we're going to be looking at rezonings applications and they are downtown, we propose that it may be suitable to see a reduction in the recommended payments or units. And we built this table. It's noted in the policy attached to your agenda today. And this table identifies the types of dwellings, the years, the recommended or suggested payment. This one here, table one, applies to affordable housing. We build both affordable housing and tangible community amenity payments within the same policy. So moving on to community amenity, much of it is very similar. The different types of density, the premium. We identify or propose a 25% reduction for downtown. We do have a downtown revitalization fund. There often are projects going in downtown that provide amenities as part of their development. It seems potentially appropriate here to offer a 25% reduction. And showing what that table likes, looks like, again, attached within your agenda today, but showing what that table looks like, including, because it is commercial, industrial, including a set amount per floor space, which again is, through our research, indicates is industry standard for that. Generally speaking, when it comes to residential units, we're looking at a unit cost per door, but with commercial, industrial, it's based on floor space. And so I examined some comparables for some consideration here based on applications that we have right now on file and what it would look like. Or if they're not on file, there are applications we've discussed which very well could be on file in the near future. So let's say a low density subdivision in West Seashell, for example, the policy would suggest $10,000 per parcel. If it's an OCP amendment, that would be a 10% premium. So that would be $11,000 per parcel. Or if it were a four lot subdivision, $44,000 for the development. Now let's say it was a 75 unit townhouse rezoning application. Townhouse is slightly less than a single family dwelling, $8,500 per door. So then let's say it was an OCP amendment, that's $9,350. But there's also some consideration about those numbers, where it's calculated, is it on the entire thing, on the lift, there's to the zoning, it depends on the scenario. And so while this policy provides details, I would suggest that there are individual scenario-dependent situations that would be presented to council in specific applications. Carrying on, a 20-unit apartment on the edge of downtown, close to downtown but not within the downtown-centered official community plan designation, apartments approximately 7,948 per unit. Whereas you can see 40-unit mixed-use building in the downtown core eligible for the discounts, and then that would be approximately 5,780 per unit if it were in the official community plan area that qualifies for a discount. That would be the end of the presentation, and certainly happy to discuss further. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Certainly makes for a good starting point. I had written down here a question for clarification, and I think you answered it in your presentation. But tables one and two would not apply if somebody, say, already owned a parcel, it was already zoned, wanted to build a house on it. Correct. Okay, thank you very much. Questions? Mayor Seegers?
Thank you. During your presentation, you talked about applying it to all or the lift only. Is that something that will be clarified in the policy so that both staff and the developer would know, or is that up for negotiation?
Yes, that comment was based on conversations that have ensued and carried on since the time that this agenda was published. So yes, it was a bit of a nugget that I dropped in on you, I acknowledge. So what we have now is a report for Committee of the Whole to consider. It would come back to council formally for adoption should we receive recommendation today. and I can clarify that in the staff report and potentially in the policy as well. Thank you.
Have you done the research in other jurisdictions? And what typically, if you have, what typically is the application? Is it on everything or typically only on the lift?
I have done a fair amount of research, and that's an interesting question, and it does depend ultimately on jurisdiction. And jurisdictions I feel what I'm proposing here is within the realm of industry standard. But sometimes there is no development without the lift, and other times it's a pure obvious benefit to both parties when there is a lift. So it's an interesting debate. I know the city of Vancouver, I know Seashell is not directly comparable, and don't get me wrong, but theirs is quite extreme, where 75% of the value of the lift goes to the city. I mean, that's on the very extreme end, right? Others is just X amount per floor space. So I think what I need to do is provide a little more clarity when coming back to council as to how to consider that portion of it. We've had quite a debate on that topic.
Councillor McLean.
Yeah, I think that conversation is very interesting because we have to look at what this bylaw will influence and how it will influence decisions that developers make. As it's written right now, there's a couple good things that it influences. The premium for amendment to the OCP, that's good. The reduction for downtown, that's good. The reduction for higher density forms, that's good. So that shifts behavior of developers by shifting the cost. So I really like to see that. The question of this, how it's structured right now versus the community amenities versus the density bonusing, this discourages people from getting a rezoning. So if your property does not need a rezoning, you can build it. You don't pay any of these fees, as I understand it. And I see a nod there. Whereas if you want to get a rezoning, then these fees kick in. So that's discouraging people from rezoning and keeping it at the current zoning, which can be quite outdated and not fitting even with the OCP vision of that community. It's because it was zoned R1 50 years ago and it's still R1 now. So if we want to develop our community, this, how it's written right now, could lead to some issues in that it discourages people from thinking bigger and planning density in areas that we all agree could use some more density, but it's not currently zoned for that density. So I do have that concern, and maybe a density bonusing structure may work a little bit better in that you're just this community amenities applied to the increased value of rezoning. So you get more out of a property if you rezone, but we take a little back for the community benefit. So that's the challenge that I'm still trying to figure out in my head and how to make that work the best.
Mayor Seegers.
Thank you. I know housing, affordable housing, different types of housing is on everybody's mind in Seashell and up and down the coast and other places as well. And I've been having conversations with BC Housing around getting some affordable housing. They don't buy land. They will provide funding for the structure, for the units, but they will not provide land. As a municipality, we don't have a war chest. We don't have money to put forward for things that the community wants, like the land for affordable housing, like additional money for the library to do some expansion, etc. I see these amounts are minimal, right? They're not high. If somebody came in and was looking to take their lot, subdivide it into two, they would contribute $10,000. They're going to make a lot more off of that lot than $10,000. If they can't, if it's not viable to provide a piece to the municipality and to the rest of the residents in the community for the services that they're going to be providing to the additional resident, then they shouldn't subdivide. We need to look out for the greater community, and I think this is a way that actually helps contribute to that where we are, because we are basically selling the subdivision rights, right, the zoning rights. And this is the municipality's, it's a contribution to the rest of the municipality for us to be able to put in some of the things that aren't necessarily coming forward from the developers and the community as a whole.
Question for staff, just clarification. Can you subdivide a property without rezoning it? Keep it under its current zoning?
Yes.
Yeah. Certainly not every property, but it is possible, yes. If you have a parcel that's large enough and a zoning that's small enough and it works for you, then it's possible, yes.
And in that case, we wouldn't receive any community amenities as this is currently written.
Go ahead.
So the next conversation that we'll be engaging in the next while is on the zoning bylaw, which will, you know, help us look at some of those kinds of things as well. Where do we want more density, and what does that look like? And how does that then tie into this community amenity and affordable housing contribution policy going forward? So, thank you.
Anybody else? Go ahead, Mr. Allen.
Thank you. The official community plan does contain direction to consider density bonusing within the zoning bylaw as well. And as council knows, staff is marching in that direction of creating a new zoning bylaw, which we're hopeful we can share with the public in the coming weeks. And there is consideration for some of that. So it's difficult to describe and explain the difference between amenity policies and density bonusing. I would suggest density bonusing is on a smaller scale, maybe a lot split, or maybe a secondary dwelling on a parcel, whereas amenity contribution policy might be the larger, hey, I want to change the official community plan or the zoning bylaw to do what I'm proposing to do on my parcel, right? So they're kind of at different levels, but there's scope for consideration of density bonusing as well. Thank you.
Councillor McLean.
Just to take us in a slightly different direction, in regards to the community amenities, how do we tie the community amenity that's being proposed to the development? What is the process for that? Because we have a long list of potential community amenities. Do they have to be related to the development, or could they be anything?
Great question. The proposed bylaw does provide a list of possibilities where that money could be spent, and that list derives from the official community plan as well as the parks and open space plan. Now, as noted, it's possible that a development might say, hey, here's an amenity, it's a piece of artwork, and we'd like to place it in Civic Square. That's very direct, right? But supposing it's money and it's collected towards a recreation facility or an all-weather sports field, and there's just one piece of the overall collection, it's a little bit harder to directly tie that, right? So.
Yeah, I'm trying to understand how this all works, so bear with me. I'm thinking of, like, maybe we have a seniors-focused development. Could they be paying into daycare? Because that's not a match. There's no link between the two. How that doesn't make sense to me, but I think that would be permitted under how we're at.
Well, the statutory reserve fund bylaw, spending of the money would always be at discretion of council. So you're right, we would be collecting a reserve fund, and where and how that money is spent is, would be depending upon council direction. As opposed, not every development's going to garner enough money for their development to specifically spend it in one spot or for one thing. But the bylaw does provide options for all age ranges within our community, from childcare through to seniors issues. So as I say, that those are decisions to be made with staff report and council decision each and every time the money is to be ultimately spent.
And some of those could take time to accrue. It might be 10, 15 years down the road that we're looking, you know, someone's looking at this pot of money and no idea how it was paid into originally, mm-hmm. but looking to spend it on something right. for our community. Mayor Seegers.
This is a policy that ties into the bylaw. right, for the reserve bylaw. So the reserve bylaw basically sets up the pot. We're going to take money in, and in negotiation with developers, as you said, they may come forward and say, you know, on our site, this is an amenity that we're looking to provide, not necessarily just for the residents of the site, but for the community to use. That could then be taken into account when looking at what their amenity contribution is. But the amenity contribution dollars will go into that reserve, and then when they're accumulated, it will be up to us to look at, are we going to spend those dollars on daycare, right? Is that the need right now in our community? Are we going to spend them on, I don't know, whatever. It's something in that list, right? There's a big list, and I think the last one says other council priorities. So as time goes on, as the money accumulates, we will then be able to address those needs that are pressing in our community. I mean, we just had a delegation in front of us. One of the issues on the Sunshine Coast is we don't have enough dry floor space for the users. Some of them, yes, are the pickleball group, but it's also the lacrosse people, it's the roller derby, right? There's a number of others, indoor soccer. We are going to be having a presentation at the regional district, I think, or we had a presentation at the regional district around sports fields, an all-weather field. Well, those cost money, right? And as we are basically selling the rights for rezoning and more dense development, those come at a cost, and our community is getting more dense, more people, and we need more services and more amenities for them. This is actually contributing to provide what the community is actually looking for.
Councillor McLean.
Yeah, so what I'm seeing here is that there's no direct connection between the development and where we're spending the money. That's an approach that I'd probably like to take personally. So the question is, do we write it in proceed policy or not? But I would like to make that connection between we have this development, they pay into the pot, let's maybe do a project in that community. So try and make some kind of connection. Because the key thing behind this is when a developer comes into the community, they need to provide community benefit. And sometimes that can be quite local, and sometimes it can be district-wide. So, I think like I'm in general support of this because developers need to provide value to our community, and that's what this bylaw sets out. The thing that's missing is that connection between the development and the community, and that's where the seven of us come in.
Anybody else down the end of that side of the table? Councillor Rowe, Councillor Scott.
I like the direction that Matt is talking about. I would think that if a developer is going to come in and build a 200 unit development and he decides that he thinks that to help sell his development, one of the commercial spaces is going to be a daycare, we would recognize that cost of that community amenity is born within that community, and we wouldn't be looking for any extra to go outside in that direction. So I agree with you, or he wants to put in a sports field or something along those lines, for sure.
Just hang on a second. Councillor Kooster, is there anything you want to add? Okay, Councillor McLean.
Yeah, just really quick. If it's on site, it has to be benefit to the broader community, not just the people living there. Yeah.
Councillor Rowe.
Well, I just want to comment that I think there'd still have to be a proven need for it. So a proven need for other than that's what the developer thinks that the community needs. It's probably going to be bang on, but I'm just not sure with varying sizes of developments how realistic that's going to be for all of them. I think it's something I'd like to dig into a bit deeper, but I hear what you're saying. And I'd actually like to know, like talk to a few of them and see if that's something that is actually of interest to them.
Councillor Kooster.
I have a question for Andrew. So these numbers here, are they like negotiable? That you have presented here when the time comes. So for example, when we were all running for election, we were talking about affordable housing. So if a developer comes in, they're going to build, I don't know, 150, 200 units. They want to make it market affordable housing versus someone who's going to do a similar size unit project that may be like not affordable, 800. Are they paying the same fees? And if that's the case, I'm not sure if I agree with that, because we should be trying to encourage what we're all trying to do for our community for affordable housing. So like, say, you know, someone's coming in, I'm just going to throw a number, $400,000 versus $800,000 units, 150 units. Will they be, if I just take this, like $3,600 per unit for blanket across, or is that all negotiable based on our community needs? Does that make sense?
As this is a policy and not a firm bylaw, there is some room for negotiation. Sure, if somebody comes in and they want to do high-end $800,000 and we're not sure that it's the right fit, or council's not sure it's the right fit, there is some room, some levers there to say, hey, we need to talk about additional amenity here. What I'm trying to do is provide some baseline, some parameters of expectations, but there is potentially, or if there's a partial contribution on site, then that could potentially be reduced. Like, there is some room there, but the idea here is to provide some predictability. Yes, but it's not a bylaw, it's a policy.
Councillor Scott?
I think I'd rather go the other way. I think I'd rather see this being the maximum that a developer, so he knows the goalpost is planted. And then when he comes to us and says, you know, I'm not looking to build an $800,000 unit, I want to build a $450,000 unit, is there room to move on this? And then we can work our way backwards. But to effectively plant a goalpost that can grow without any boundary, I think we're going the wrong way there.
Mayor Seegers first.
So that would be a question. If we did this as a bylaw, is there flexibility inside the bylaw? Versus if we do it as a policy, I think we would typically see these as the maximums, and then they would go down from there if the developer was providing other amenities, or is that how it would be applied is what I'm looking for.
Correct. If the developer were providing other amenities that were deemed suitable to council, then there's room for movement here. This is what we propose. Pardon me, to start with. Ultimately, we provide recommendations. Council makes a decision. Is this appropriate? Is this a suitable contribution to consider moving forward? Right. The thing about market and targets is they're based on expectations and targets. If it's not tied into a housing agreement, then it's not a firm ultimate final price. So that's why there's some consideration for a little bit of a identifying a fixed term. It's at council's discretion. These are numbers that I provided that I think are loosely based on average. So $5,000 would be $10,000 payment. I've seen some as high as $17,000, some as lower than this, but I'm trying to find, for a starting point, a general industry average.
Councillor McLean.
Yeah, I see this as, the best word I have is baseline, but it's something that can go up or down. If there is a development that's coming into this community that the developer thinks that they may not have community support, they can offer to provide much more community amenities, and we'll take that into the calculation when approving it. So if somebody wants to put that in there, they're welcome to. But we have a baseline, we have a starting point. And I think that's what I'm really looking forward, is that basic expectation of this is where we start, and if it needs to go up or down, that's what we talk about, but this is generally what we are thinking. And that's what I think the value of this policy is.
Councillor Cooster.
I was just going to say, I agree with Eric. Like, I don't think we can go up, because the whole idea is we want people to be able to come in, know what they're getting right from the get-go, and maybe it can go down. Yes, if they're going to give us, you know, affordable units, which we all want in our community, but not go up. Like, I don't think that that's even an option here.
Okay. Anybody else? Mayor Seegers.
I think we're talking two different things. I think, you know, what are we asking for as a contribution? This is what we're asking for as a contribution. Council McLean was saying if somebody comes into the community and they're looking to sell the community on something, you know, if they came, if we had some, I mean, what we see in other communities is sometimes they'll come in and they'll build a school.
Yeah.
Right? They'll build a school and give it to the school district. Are we going to see that here? Most likely not. But if we had somebody who came here and said, you know what, I want to build this subdivision and I'll give you a school, would we say no? I don't think so. So they can offer more. I think the conversation on our end is this is what we're asking. If they want to give us more, we'll take it.
Yep.
We've got a fair bit of discussion here, and then you mentioned the whether it would be on the lift or on all of it. One of the options we have available to us on page 19, option 3, is that council refer draft policy to the Advisory Planning Commission for review prior to consideration of adoption. I'm just wondering, based on where we are now, if that would be our preference today. Mayor Seegers?
I'll move that recommendation, that this draft policy go to the Advisory Planning Commission for review prior to consideration of adoption.
Seconded? Okay. Yep. Councillor McLean, you wanted to say something?
Yeah, I'd like to amend that to add the housing committee as well for comments.
I'll second that amendment for purposes. Would anybody like to speak to the amendment first? No? All those in favor? Oh, sorry.
I just want to say, I think it's important that, we do send it to Advisory Planning and Housing Committee, of course. But also, talk to some of the stakeholders, like the Sunshine Coast, like Kayla from Sunshine Coast Affordable Housing, because she has done a lot of legwork already. She's talked to, obviously, she's very vested in our whole Sunshine Coast. She's talked to developers. She knows what the need is and where the stumbling blocks are, I think. So I think that's a good person that we, you know, talk to some of the stakeholders as well.
Okay. Mayor Seegers.
Sure.
Thank you. Just it's echoing when it does that. I think the Housing Committee actually has the Affordable Housing Society on it. So by referring to the Housing Committee, we'll actually be getting that input.
All right. Voting on the amendment first. All those in favor? Nobody opposed? That carries. Okay, so option 3, give that council refer draft policy to the Advisory Planning Commission and the Housing Committee for review prior to consideration of adoption. Anybody want to speak to that? Or are we good to go? All those in favor? Opposed? Carried? All right. Thank you very much. That's that. All right, motion to adjourn. Moved. Seconded. All in favor? Great. Thank you.